Okay, we now come to the chapter 6, which is the microwave digital signal processing chapter. Now, in this chapter, what are the things that we are going to look at? Is decimation, interpolation, and what is decimation? That means reducing the sampling rate. Interpolation means increasing the sampling rate. Then sampling rate conversion by non-integer factor. Then we'll be looking at particularly decimation by 2 and interpolation by 2. First thing that you need to know, what is a multi-rate system or multi-rate processing? So far we have looked at a system where it's only one sampling rate throughout the system. Input is one sampling rate, the same sampling rate for the output. In a multi-rate system, you could have an input at one sampling rate and output would be at a different sampling rate. So that's what we are going to look at now. In most of the digital signal processing nowadays, we do need to operate on a multi-rate system. That means multi-rate means different sampling rates. Okay. So there are two primary operations that we have. The two primary operations that we have are decimation. What's the decimation? We decrease the sampling rate FS to a particular frequency. For example, you may start at 8 kilohertz your input sampling. You want the output to be at 2 kilohertz, and there are applications, and I'll come back to that in a minute. So which is called downsampling sometimes. Interpolation means we are going to increase the sampling rate. You can see that. I'm going to increase the sampling rate. So I'll demonstrate this in a minute with the system actually. So basically the process of decimation and interpolation is an important part, important operation for a multi-rate system. So we are going to study how do we decrease the sampling rate, how do we increase the sampling rate, what sort of process that we have to go through. Okay? So let's look at the first one, which is decimation. So that means sampling rate decreaser. So I could say, here is my signal coming in here, which has got a discrete signal at N0, N1, N2, N3, you're given the value, and it's called Xn, sequence Xn, at a sampling frequency Fn. You don't know the sampling frequency at the moment. And I want to get an output here. The output here, Fs over M. M is going to be 3 here in this case. So I'm going to say, I'm going to decrease my sampling rate by 3. That means, for example, if this is 24 kilohertz here, at that point, it's going to end up, this sequence is going to be 8 kilohertz. And that's the reason, you can see I've got different sequence. If that's N, this is going to be M. So what does that mean, decreasing by 3? That means you're going to retain that number, that's going to be retained, you can see that. You're going to drop, these two are going to be dropped, and you're going to retain that one, so that's there, and the next two are going to be dropped because you are decreasing by 3, and the next one is retained. So this is a new sequence, and you will find the first value remains same. Now this has been renumbered, and this will become as the first value, and this will become as the second value. That's the reason I have got an index M. So basically, if you say that you're going to decimate by 3, that means we retain just every third sample. We retain every third sample of the signal. That's called decimation. So this may be at a higher sampling rate, and this may be at a low sampling rate. Let's move on and have a look at an example here. Here's a concrete example for you, where you can extend an input signal, and I've just put in for simplicity some values here. And we're going to downsample this by 2. What does that mean? You retain every second sample. Downsample by 3 means you retain every third sample. In this case, you retain every second sample. You will retain that one here. You will get rid of that.
and you will retain this one, you will get rid of that one, and then you will retain this one, and so on.
So I didn't complete this, just, and so on it happens. Okay? So here you will remove that, and you retain this one, and you remove that, and you retain that one. That is your new sequence. This is M, different sampling, and this is M in a different sampling. You can see the number of samples here is higher, double that compared to this one. So basically, all we are saying is, as I said to you, if M is 3, if you are down sampling by 3, you just take every third sample. So obviously it makes sense that in order to reduce the sampling rate, that you must band limit. Remember, we said if your sampling rate is FS, your signal should be band limited to FS over 2. Now if your sampling rate is going to be FS over 3, then your signal should be band limited to FS over 6. So you must follow that. Otherwise, you're going to cause aliasing. So naturally, you know, you cannot just drop the samples like that. You cannot do that. If you do that, what's happening is you are already causing aliasing. So if you want to decimate, what do you have to do first? You must make sure you say, if this is going to be 24 kilohertz, you know, or if this is 24 kilohertz, and if this is going to be 8 kilohertz, then we have to make sure this signal goes through a low-pass filter where the bandwidth is 4 kilohertz of the low-pass filter. Then you can operate at 8 kilohertz. So if you do not band limit here, then this process will cause aliasing. So you can only do downsampling if your signal goes through a low-pass filter. So let's move on to the next page where you can see that very clearly. So this diagram actually shows M decimator. So what you have to do, you make sure this is your signal, you work out what is going to be your sampling rate is going to be. Then once you know what the sampling rate is, so say this is going to be, say, 4 kilohertz. And this is, say, 20 kilohertz, for example. And therefore, the digital low-pass filter must have a bandwidth of 2 kilohertz. Mm-hmm. If you're going to end up with 4 kilohertz, you must have this is 2 kilohertz sampling, a bandwidth. If you don't have that, then you will cause aliasing. So what you do is you take your 20 kilohertz filter, pass it through a digital filter of bandwidth of 2 kilohertz, still your signal is still 20 kilohertz. We haven't decimated yet. So this is FS and this is also FS. Now you downsample by 3, or in this case you are downsampling by 5, because you want, so this is going to be 5. As soon as you do that, this frequency now is 4 kilohertz. So digital low pass filter is given as a low pass filter. This cutoff frequency is going to be FS over 2 divided by M. That means this is FS over M divided by 2, which is 2 kilohertz. So that is how you work out your digital filter. So the in summary, if you have a signal coming at a one particular sampling rate, and if you want an output at a different sampling rate, you must have a low-pass filter which filters the signal, and then you have a downsampler. Okay? So this diagram that you need to follow. So here is a simple example of a kind of very schematic diagram here. You can see here is a signal FS coming in and digitally low pass filter, and then I'm downsampling and I'm getting my signal back. Oh well, I'm getting a reduced signal. So let's look at the spectrum as well as the signal. This is my signal. Xn is, this is my signal here. And this is my spectrum. And remember that in this example, I'm going to make M equal to 3. So M equal to 3. So I have to make sure This is fs over 2m, its cutoff frequency is fs over 2m, right? And because this is fs over m here, the sampling frequency is going to end up. So the digital filter should be half of that. Half of that will be fs over 2m. So you remove signal, this part, out using a low-pass filter. But the signal is still same as this one because they're both the same sampling frequency. Don't forget, here, here the same sampling frequency so far. And then what happened is you're going to downsample now because your signal is ready for downsampling. Here is at a higher sampling rate. Here is also the same sampling rate but digitally low-pass filtered at the correct bandwidth. So signal is ready for sampling, downsampling. Now, downsampling by 3 means you retain every third sample. So you retain the there one, that one is retained. Then third one means until this is retained. Then these two are dropped. This is retained. And this is retained. And so on. Every third sample is now retained. So this signal now has a bandwidth of fs over 3. By the way, fs is divided by 3. And that's just another example or another explanation of how this downsampling happened. Okay, here's an example for you if you want to look at it. I have got a 6 kilohertz signal coming in, a 6 kilohertz sampling. It goes through a low pass filter, which is still 6 kilohertz. And I'm going to downsample, so it's going to be 2 kilohertz here. It's going to be 2 kilohertz here. So that's 2 kilohertz here. If the sampling frequency is going to be 2 kilohertz, what's the bandwidth of this? Of course, it's going to be 1 kilohertz. Because you have to follow the sampling theorem. So it's going to be 1 kilohertz. So this is just a small example of a decimation process. Note, okay, where do we use this? For example, you may ask, give us an application. Okay, in a lot of signal processing applications, you get your speech data or image data or maybe an ECG signal, all of them at a high sampling rate to avoid analog filtering. They do it at very high sampling. And then you get all this data on a CD, so you get them all in a CD like this, a lot of data at a high sampling rate. Now you have an application, telephone application or some other application, where you only want 8 kilohertz sampling. So what you need to do, you take your 32 kilohertz coming in, your signal that's from your CD, you pass it through a low pass filter, and then you do a down sampling, that means drop the sample, and you get your signal at 8 kilohertz. So the bandwidth is 0 to 4 here. So this is just a typical example. You do get a lot of CDs. You can buy them for language identification, speech recognition, speaker verification. All this data has been sampled and stored on a CD, and people can then get the CD, and then you can downsample at the rate that you need for your system. The question comes in now is, the low-pass filter that you use, this digital low-pass filter that you are using, this low-pass filter that you are using, is that going to be an analog filter? That low-pass filter, is it going to be an IIR filter or FIR filter? That's the question. That's what I'm looking at in the next slide. Should we use an IIR digital filter or an FIR digital filter? You can start to think about it. What happens if you use IIR filter? If you want a linear phase, of course you will use FIR filter. But you will find if you want to do decimation and computationally efficient decimation, you have to use FIR filter all the time. Why? Because take an example here, whether I can draw it here, I'm not sure. The signal coming here at FS, and you are down sampling here, so filtering here, filter, and then you get your signal out here at the same sampling, FS, and then you decimate them. You see? So if you're going to get samples
here, coming out here, after the filter, if you use IIR filter here, IIR filter, you must calculate every sample. If you've got 10 samples here, you must have 10 samples here.
You must calculate every sample.
So, it's a bit of waste because you're doing 10 samples, and then here, if you say decimate by 2 means, you're dropping a lot of samples. You're only retaining first and the second and the fourth and so on. So, it seems to be a waste here, calculating all the samples and then dropping them. But if you're using IIR filter, of course you have to keep all the samples to be calculated because the first sample depends on the previous samples, depends on the IIR filter you use. The second sample you calculate output is depends on the previous values, previous outputs. But if you use FIR filter here, what will happen? FIR filter, current output only depends on the past input, not on past output. So therefore, what you could do very cleverly, you decide the sample you want to retain, you only calculate those samples. So if this is an FIR filter, you can calculate only those samples. So you don't need to calculate the samples in between because you're going to drop them out. So FIR filter allows you to calculate the ones that you want because the current sample does not depend on the past output for FIR. But if you use IIR filter, you must calculate every sample, every output, and then drop them out. If it is FIR filter, you don't need to calculate every one of them. So therefore, you only calculate that. So for FIR filter, these two kind of become together. Like means, you filter only the ones that you want, and the other ones you don't calculate. You know, by knowing what value you are going to have, sampling, downsampling by 2, means you have to have the first value, so you filter them through the FIR. You don't need the second value because you are downsampling by 2, so you don't calculate that. Then you take the third value, yes, you filter them, third value. The fourth value, you're throwing it out, so you don't need to calculate. Then you get the fifth value, so 1, 2, 3, it comes out. Okay? So in this application, people normally use FIR filter for computational efficiency and IIR filter is not used. So you should be able to explain why you use FIR filter in this digital low-pass application as opposed to IIR filter. Now we move on to interpolation. Now, what is interpolation? Interpolation means here that you have a signal coming in, FS, sampling rate, but what you want to increase the sampling rate. That's what interpolation means. You want to increase the sampling rate. So how do you increase the sampling rate? It's the question. So what do we have to do, how do we increase the sampling rate is, we need to have some sort of sampling rate increaser there. So if you start with 10 samples here, 10 samples, and if this is equal to 2, you must have 20 samples. So the question is, if you want to reduce the sample, it's easy. You can just throw them out. But if you want to increase the sample, it's not easy. So what we do is, this is the trick we do. You know, if this is a sample, and this is the next sample, if you want to increase by 2, we put in 1 0 in between. And next 0. So you got, if you start with 2 samples, you will end up with 4 samples. But these samples are zeros. But you have to find a way of calculating these values. We'll look at it in a minute. So that's what is being represented here, where you're saying interpolation may involve inserting between any samples n minus 1 zeros. So you must include n minus 1 zeros. Okay? Okay, let's look at an example. I mean, it's easy to look at through an example, okay? Here is your input signal, and you want to upsample by 2, that means going up by 2, that means you need to get double the number of samples. So what you do is normally is that you retain the first one, and you insert a 0 here, see it? And then you retain next one, you insert a 0, then retain next one, you insert a zero, and so on. You could double the number of samples there. Now, for example, if you want to upsample by three for the same sequence, you retain the first one here, and then you got two zeros in between. So whenever you got three here, if this is L, you insert L minus one zeros. That's what you have to do. You have to insert L minus one zeros. And see, for the next sample, if you look at the next sample, there you are. That's retained, and then two zeros are included. And so on. Okay? That's how you do interpolation. But we have to find a way of getting these zeros. Initially you put zeros, and then you need to calculate the value at that position. Okay, at that position. So how do we do that? Let's look through this interpolation technique through our spectrum. Okay? Now if you look at it very carefully, it takes a while to understand. Once you understand, it's very simple. Here's the signal, Xn, Xn with the sampling frequency Fs, to be interpolated by 2. So we say L equal to 4. We can take L equal to 4. So I must end up here equal to 4 Fs. This is what I want. That's what I need. So let me write the spectrum, draw the spectrum. The spectrum is between fundamental region, between there and there. That's your signal. And so repeating there. 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. It just repeats. Again, repeats here as well. Now, you know, in this case, the sampling frequency, this is half the sampling, and this is your sampling. That part is your sampling frequency. Now, you're saying you are increasing the sampling to 4 Fs, aren't you? So, if you want to increase the sampling frequency to 4 Fs, it's not there, it's not there, it's not here. That's where your next spectrum, this part, should appear at 4 Fs. So what do we need to do is start from this spectrum, and we need to remove one. That should be removed. That should be removed. That should be removed. If you want to go from here to here, what you need to do, you have to make sure these three are removed so that you end up with that one. And that one at the end, and similarly on this side as well. So how do we do that? Basically, it's very simple. What you will do is pass the signal after you interpolate them. After interpolation only gives you that. Pass it through a low pass filter, which something goes like that. I will just remove that. So you can see naturally, if you really want interpolation, removing these three unwanted components mean passing the signal at this point through a low-pass filter. So, in this here, if you've got a signal 1, value 1, 8, comma 9, what you have here would be 1, you need to put 3 zeros, 4 minus 1, 1, 2, 3 zeros, then 8, 3 zeros and 9. That's your sequence comes here. Now, you pass the sequence through a low pass filter, which will remove these. That means these will start to come up with values now. These will have values now, not zeros anymore. Because the low pass filter will make sure it does a good interpolation between those two. So if you look at the next slide, that shows you that very clearly. The next slide is basically, I'm just explaining the same thing again. To get this, what you need to do is you need a low pass filter to low pass this. That's all I'm saying. So, and then you get your signal, y theta. So, here's the interpolator, exactly what I explained. And let's go through this with more detail. At that point, this is my signal, Xn. See? Now I'm going to interpolate by L. That means I have to introduce L minus one zeros. So L is in this case 3. Therefore I have to introduce 2 zeros in between. So here is my signal. First one is retained. I put a zero here. Second 2 zeros. And the third one is retained. I got a 4 zero. Fifth zero. And the sixth one is retained. And I start to put zero. So that's the signal
that signal, this one is at that point, and this one is going to be at that point. Now, you have to pass this through a digital low-pass filter. Remember, I explained to you earlier, if you pass this through a digital low-pass filter, it will then pull these all up, these ones will come up. So, you can see even at that point, the signal output is now, looks like this, which is these all have come up, you see, all the zeros that you have has come up. Low-pass filter does an interpolation, and you have got your signal back. So basically, that's how you do interpolation. So in summary, if I could explain, if you are decimating, you have the low-pass filter first, and then the decimator afterward. If you are interpolating, you have got your interpolator first, and the low-pass filter afterward. Okay? So look at those two diagrams very carefully, two different operations, and two different functions. So we can go back and argue and what sort of filter you need. Obviously the filter that we need is an FIR, but why I explained to you earlier why FIR is the same thing here as well. So FIR filter is what you need for interpolation or decimation as well. So here's a simple example, two examples of decimation and interpolation. I just done a different way. I just took a sequence here, and then I have a low-pass filter, which I have got a impulse response of half-half. It's a symmetrical low-pass filter, correct? So what I have, how do I get the sequence Pn? I take this one and convolve with Hn. So Pn equal to Xn convolve with Hn. So that means I take that signal, and this one to convolve, I get Pn. So Pn is that now. Now what you have to do, in practical terms, you only calculate the every second one. But anyway, here what you have to do now, you have to drop the samples. Every second one, you keep them. So you keep the fourth one, you keep the next one, that one, and then you keep the that one, and so on. So you drop that. So this is just the way normal filtering is done. But you will find, when you do the real-time implementation, what would you do? These two are included together, because an FIR filter, this is an FIR filter. So what would you do is, you don't calculate PN, you calculate straight YN. How do you calculate? You calculate this one first, then you don't calculate that at all. Then you calculate this one there. You don't calculate this one, then you calculate that one. So these two are kind of included in the FIR filter. Although it's easy to visualize in this way rather than combine together. But in practice, that's what happened. Okay? If you're not sure about how it is combined, you can ask me in the tutorial class. I can just run through that individually for you if you're not sure. I can write a few examples for you and show you why you have to calculate and why you have to combine them and where the computational efficiency comes into play. Now, same operation I have done is for a interpolation case. So I started the signal of that, and so I have to interpolate them. That means insert 0. Insert 0 means L minus 1. This is L equal to 2. L minus 1, 0, so I have to, that means 1, 0. So this is my signal, and I now put in 0, 1, 0 in between sample, and that's the signal there. So the sampling rate has changed now. Okay, so if this is FS, this will be 2FS. It's changed now. Correct? Now that signal now has to go through this filter. That means filter is already given as this one. So PM convolved with that will get you YM. So PN convolved with HN will get the YM. So that's your output signal. The sampling frequency is 2 times of FS. So if you had only 5 samples here, you will end up with 10 samples there. Because you have increased the number of samples, because you have increased the sampling frequency, so your rate is increased. So that's a basic example. Here is another example that you can work out yourself and see you've been given the band, which is 2 kilohertz, sampling is 8 kilohertz. You are upsampling by 3. So this is going to be 24 kilohertz. So this is going to be 24 kilohertz. The question is,
the low pass filter will operate at 24 kilohertz. Its sampling frequency is 24. So question is, what's the bandwidth? So everybody would say, if you're going to have a sampling frequency of 24, this must have minimum 12 kilohertz. That is true, but what's the minimum bandwidth in this case? In this case, you only have 2 kilohertz. You are not increasing the bandwidth. You can't. You have already cut off your signal. Therefore, you don't need 12. So this should be 2 kilohertz is sufficient to design a filter with 2 kilohertz. 12 is not the correct answer. 12 is, must be your, the maximum bandwidth you can have if you are sampling at 24. But your original signal is at 2 kilohertz. You are not going to get additional frequencies coming in. Therefore, you can retain a 2 kilohertz a cutoff frequency here. So FC here is 2 kilohertz. It's a correct answer. You can't go below 2. Okay. So far, the sampling decimation and interpolation is all done by an integer factor. That means you're sampling, down sampling by 2, up sampling by 4. That's what we have done so far. But in reality, you may not be able to do all the time. There are requirements where your sampling rate, decrease rate and increasing rate has to be kind of a non-integer value. If it's a non-integer value, how do you do that? For a non-integer factor, you have to do, how do we do for non-integer factor? So there are applications where you have to do that. So how do we do that? Okay, this is the way you do that. Let's have a look at the next one. And here's an example I'm giving you. I have a signal, a compact disk system has a rate of 44.1 kilohertz. And I want to convert that sample digital data, which is on a CD, and I want to copy that into a DAT tape, DAT tape, digital audio tape, which is operating at 48 kilohertz. So the range there, like, the, it's non-integer value, the sampling value. So how do I go about doing it? So I have to have a rate which is 48 divided by 44.1. How can I do this achievement? How do I do this? So, what you need to do, you upsample and then downsample. So you increase your sampling rate and then you decrease it by integer factor. Because they are in cascade, one up, one down, you will find the non-integer value you can get. So sampling frequency change is achieved by first interpolating the data by L, you see that? And then decimating by M. So that's what you do. So first interpolate by L and then decimate by M. Let's look at an example here. Here's the conversion process that I need. I have signals at 44.1. And I want to end up at 48 kilohertz. So I have to go up. So I put in L there. L is 48,000. M is 44,000.1. I write down this in factors of 2. It's common, it's prime factors. And here also you write them. And you cancel out. You get 160 over 147 will maintain this ratio. So I can say, I will do upsampling by 160 and then downsampling by 147. I will get this sampling ratio. I will end up with 48 kilohertz. So that's how you do, that's where you do non-integer sampling. You have to upsample and then downsample. Here is the example. How do you do upsampling? You put in zeros there, upsample and then low pass filter. Then the signal is available, you know what's L, you know what's M, now low pass filter again, and then you downsample, and you get your signal back. So eventually, the ratio that you wanted is obtained here, L over M times FS will give you the 48 kilohertz, if you have it correctly done.
If M is
greater than,
you will find, you can work out example, if M is greater than L, then it's a decimation. If M is less than L, it becomes an interpolation. And if you go back in the previous example, M here is less than L, and come back, M is less than L, therefore it's an interpolation, we did, because we were going from 44.1 to 48. If you just go through this carefully, you will find this easily you can understand. You can try a few examples and work out this ratio, okay?
Now, the next part is this. You could ask the question, why do you need these two low-pass filters? They're two digital low-pass filters.
They are also in a cascade chain. If they're in a cascade chain, what will happen? The lower cutoff will predominate. If this is 4 kilohertz bandwidth, if this is, say, 2 kilohertz bandwidth, I'm just saying, the overall bandwidth is going to be 2 kilohertz. So what we can do is we can combine these two filters together and select a common cutoff frequency, and that would be enough for this particular non-integer decimation or interpolation. So going to the diagram, I have now combined the low-pass filter together, and I got. Now you have to make sure this cutoff frequency is selected such that it has got the minimum value. So you can say the cutoff frequency is minimum of 1 over L or 1 over M. Whichever the one which gives the minimum is the cutoff frequency that you have to do. And another way of looking at it, a lot of people use this way, another way of looking at it, look at your final sampling. Look at, from the final sampling, you can work out what should be the cut. Look at the input spectrum, look at the bandwidth of the input, look at the output sampling frequency, and from that, you can work out what should be the cutoff frequency. So here's an example that I would like you to calculate. I want you to go and work out what's the value of L and what's the value of M in order to get 20 kilohertz. That's what you have to work it out. And just tell me then what you have to do. So you could say, like, if you go and say it's going to be, well, I leave it to you, because 20 over 8, and work out the factors, and then you upsample and downsample, and you get the value. And also, you want to work out what is your bandwidth of your filter as well in this particular case. You can naturally see it's 20 you are ending up, so you must have a bandwidth of maximum 10, but you don't need a 10 because your signal is sampled at 8 kilohertz, so it's going to be 4 there, so this should be 4 would be sufficient, you don't need 10. So that's what you have to figure it out, okay? I leave that to you to try it out. If not, you can ask me in the tutorial class. I'll run that through again. Now, this is just an illustration of the same thing, non-integer value. In this case, what I've done, I've got a signal here. I'm interpolating by 3. So I put the 2 zeros in there, new signal. And I filter them, so I get the filtered output. Now, I'm downsampling by 2. So I retain that one, and that one, and so on. So I'm retaining the sample, and this is your sample that you get now. So this is the process of non-integer value. So in this case, the non-integer value is 1.5. So it's going to be output sample 1.5 times of FS. So if the input is, if this is FS, this is going to be, this sampling frequency is going to be 1.5 times FS. So that's how you do that, work out the non-integer sampling factors, okay? So that's in summary, that's all we need to know, upsampling, downsampling, or decimation interpolation. And this terminology that you have to be careful. In some case, if you say upsampling and downsampling, part of that mean is that you're going in sampling rate up and down without the filters. But decimation interpolation means you must have the filters in there. So there's a slight mix-up of terminology you will come across when you read the book. but make sure you read a few times so that you have got a full understanding of what is meant by upsampling, what's meant by downsampling, what's meant by decimation, what's meant by interpolation. Decimation and interpolation would have the digital filters for decimation at the front and interpolation at the back, whereas just basic upsampling, downsampling is just inserting zeros or dropping the samples, okay? But have a look anyway, it's not that, not that. Now we are going to draw a spectrum. Now we have come to a point where we are going to learn about downsampling, upsampling, and going to draw spectrum. In this case, decimation by two, some books will do decimation by two, but without any filters, right? So that means aliasing is going to be there. So we sometimes aliasing is allowed in some multi-rate system, and then when you add the signal at the output, it cancels out. Therefore, the multi-rate system when you develop, you allow aliasing, right? But the first part of the course is without allowing aliasing, you learned. That means interpolation, decimation, and non-integer sampling rate conversion. They all no aliasing. But you can allow a system with aliasing. Let's go through this bit in detail and try to draw a spectrum, okay? Here is a signal, XL, comes in, time signal. And you are downsampling by two. There's no filters, anything. So the new signal is going to be X2L, right? So that's your new signal. So if I now write the transform for this without filter, I could show proof, which you don't need to prove this, that because that would be the term. This term is due to aliasing. If I would have put a filter here, that term would have been gone. If I would have put a filter here, then this is gone. But it's not gone because there's no filter. So because of the aliasing, what happens is you write the y theta, so you substitute that equal e to the j. This equation is, you don't need to remember, it will be given to you. And most of the time you'll be given. And then you work out the signal and you find x e to the j pi theta 2, that's theta 2, x e to the minus j, here's the mistake, here's minus, it should be on the top here. No, that's okay, that's okay. So x minus means you need to have a minus pi here because cos theta or 2 minus pi, you substitute anything, and that's your signal. So you got two spectra, original and aliased. This is your alias signal, that's your original. So if you draw this if you draw the magnitude spectrum, this is your original spectrum here. There you are, that's your original spectrum. And the important part, when you downsample, and we can show by theory, which we haven't done, is that this amplitude, when you do the downsampling, will move to half. You see? Always. So if you downsample by 3 here, it will be 1/3. So that's important to know. And what happens is, you will find, when you do the downsampling, the spectrum that you had is what we call stretched. That moves towards 2 pi, that point moves towards 2 pi. Here, look, the red one is here and here. And this blue one also will move here, and that will also move here. So the spectrum is stretched. So this is your new spectrum now. And you can see, because you didn't have your low-pass filter, your original spectrum is the red one, being interacted with an alias signal. So this is full aliasing happening here. So it's called the extreme aliasing, because the signal will look like, if you draw this, it will be flat. We started the signal like that because you forgot to put the filter, you get alias signals, right? So what's the key part here is you need to know is when you do decimation, when you go by 2 or n, two things important. The spectrum, magnitude spectrum is stretched, and the amplitude is divided from 1 to 1 over 2 or 1 to 1 over 3, depends on the sample decimation. If it's decimation by 3, the amplitude will go from 1 to 1 over 3. Okay? That's for the decimation case. Let's go for interpolation. decimation by 2, I'm showing another case here. Here's an example.
Here, this is your original signal, my signal.
Now you decimate by 2. So what happened? First thing you have to do is 1 goes half, even though the scale is not right. Then this will, pi over 2 multiplied by 2 will go to pi. So that's stretched to pi. And that's stretched to pi. And this one also go here. And also this one will jump here. So you can see the signal is not aliased. Because you have already filtered the signal and you remove this part. Therefore, remove the part and the part before decimation. Therefore, it's not aliasing. So no aliasing in this case. Interpolation. What is interpolation? There's no filter again. We are just putting zeros in it. As soon as you do that, you can show xn and ym as a signal. Now you can say, this is your original signal you had. And that means y set equal xz squared is the transform theory y. So it's over x2 theta. What does that mean, x2 theta mean? X2 theta means like sine theta, sine 2 theta. Sine theta is the period of that. Sine 2 theta means complex. Okay? So within that one sine theta period, you get two periods now. So here also it's the same thing. What happened is, between pi and that, when you do upsampling by 2, you get two images. There's one here, and a half image here, and a half image here. So there are two images. Two of these are here. But remember, that does not change. That only changes for decimation, not for interpolation. It doesn't change for interpolation. Okay? So, for interpolation, the spectrum is compressed. So, if you have interpolation by 3, then you have got 3 images, 3 of these, 3 of these, like that will be there within minus pi to plus pi. Within minus pi to plus pi, you will have 3 of those. So, let's look at an example. Now we start to draw some spectrum and see whether we are able to do this, okay? Okay, the spectrum is this. Here you go. We've got given an input signal. This is kind of an arbitrary structure where the signal is downsampled, decimated, and then it's interpolated, then it's going through a filter. The filter is given. And you can see very clearly, because you're going to go decimated, the 1 is going to be 1/3. Your signal amplitude is down. So you have to get the signal amplitude back at the output. So what you do is, if you're down by 3, you make sure you filter gain at 3. So 1/3 will now be multiplied by 3. So the gain at this point and the gain at that point will become same. Do you see that? So I'll show that to you in the diagram. So let's take this diagram. This is your spectrum. The spectrum is at pi over 3, and I'm going to go through this process. And very easy, you can see this, very, very clearly. Here's the original signal, xn. Now you're saying the original signal is downsampled, decimated by 3. What does that mean? That means this goes 1/3, and this is multiplied by 3, so that position moves to here, so it moves there. That multiplied by 3, that position moved here, so it's nicely there. So that's your new image. Now what happened is that beam interpolated by 3. So 3 of these have to happen between pi and minus pi. So you got 1, 2, 3. That's the same magnitude, 1 over 3rd, as repeats. So interpolation compressed the spectrum and the magnitude is kept same. But you started with 1, at this point you are 1/3. You are now passing through a filter which has got a gain of 3. So the filter will filter between 0 and pi over 3. Anything here onwards, the filter will take out anything from this side to this side. That means from pi over 3 onwards, that's gone and that's gone. So you will get your signal back under this process without losing it. You could turn around and ask, why are you doing this? In microwave system, all sort of things can happen, and which you will learn under signal processing 2 is a major chapter in multi-rate system. and you need to know under signal processing one how to draw this magnitude spectrum. Whether you need to stretch them or whether you need to compress them, that you need to know that. Okay? So that's just an example of this end of the example also. It's all in your notes, but have a look here. In this case, you might now say, here's my signal coming in. It's being interpolated by 3, goes through a common filter, and decimated by 5. What is my spectrum at the output? That's what the question is. This is at pi over 5. Where's pi over 5? Yeah, cutoff frequency of the filter is pi over 5. That's pi over 5. And if you pass this through spectrum, what would be the output spectrum? So when you do that, draw that first spectrum, then draw this spectrum, that's W theta, then draw this one, and then draw Y theta. All magnitude spectrum. So let's look at the next diagram. It's all done in one single diagram. You can see here now, here is the signal. Started with 1. That's my original signal. It was interpolated by 3. So I must have 3 of these within pi n minus pi. That's pi. That's minus pi. I've got 1, 2, 3. I've got 3 of those. Magnitude won't change there. Now, it's being passed through a filter. Filter has a cutoff which is a pi over 5. So for anything from that point there, anything from pi over 5, that point will be taken out. So if you pass this through this filter, what you end up is that part. So that's where you end up with W theta. Now you're going to downsample by 5. I think that's 5 there. If you downsample by 5, this will go 1 over 5. Aha, I haven't marked it. Oh, I do. I have marked it. 1 over 5. And this one will be multiplied by 5, that point. That will stretch to pi. And that will stretch to pi and here. So that's your final spectrum. So that's how you draw the spectrum. It's not difficult. It's not difficult to draw the spectrum. Okay? Okay, we have finished this example. We now move on to the next one. The next one, we want to look at modulation. The modulation is the you probably have come across modulation already in communications, digital communication, analog communication. So we're going to look at digital modulation example, and then we are trying to draw some spectrum. Here's the signal, a spectrum x theta, multiplied by carrier frequency, the digital oscillator giving theta naught oscillating frequency, and when you multiply them, basically what we call a suppressed carrier, and you get u theta. So that means, if this is your spectrum here, magnitude spectrum, then when you multiply, you will learn in telecommunication, or you have already learned, what you get is, you get this spectrum repeated in 2 places, centered around the carrier frequency. This is the carrier frequency, oscillation frequency, and this spectrum, original spectrum, will be shifted to this and this one, and also shifted such that this amplitude is half. You see that? So we can actually show that xn multiplied by cos theta n is equal to half x theta minus theta naught, x theta plus theta naught. The half x theta minus theta naught, it belongs to that. That is, this way is x theta minus theta naught. Half x theta plus theta naught that way. It's like kind of a delay and advance, remember? Remember we did that? If you do the same thing with the sine theta, then you get this one, and this sine will go minus, and then this spectrum, 1 over 2j. There's a phase shift. If you multiply by exponential, instead of sine and cosine, but combination of that, then you only get one part, which is x theta plus theta naught, that will be that side. So these rules that you need to know, but the equations would be given to you. So you don't need to remember the equation, but it's simple to remember. So basically in a modulation scheme, this is what happened. When you have a modulation, what happened is that the original spectrum here will be shifted to a position, the position of the carrier frequency. Okay? Let's go and apply this this principle for and draw a spectrum for a system, a multi-rate system, right? Here's an example. In this example, you can see I have got an analog signal, and sampling period is 0.4 milliseconds, and it's multiplied by a carrier. Carrier frequency is omega naught, and then it's passed through a low-pass filter with a gain of 10 and the cutoff frequency of 125 hertz, and then it's downsampled by 10. And you can normally know that you must have a gain of 10 here, and downsample 10 will come down by 10 and multiply by 10, and this channel will give you the same amplitude here and there. You've been asked to draw the spectrum. You've been asked to draw a spectrum at that point, and that point. There, there, there. You have to draw. This is the equation given to you, so the modulation scheme. So let's see how we can draw it. So we can draw it in one page, one after another, one below other, each other, right? Right. Let's look at this one here. I have to first calculate the sampling frequency, 1 over T, which is 2.5 kilohertz. I need to calculate theta naught, which is given, which is 2 pi 10 to the 3 over 0.4. That is, theta naught is, you know, 2 pi FA over FA. And I calculate that, I got that. I calculate the carrier frequency, theta C, which is 0.15. So I know all of these, I calculate them, all of them in advance. So once I've calculated this, let's start to draw the spectrum. This is my input spectrum given. Input spectrum, you go back to the diagram, I go back again to that. Input spectrum is given here. You can see that? Your input spectrum is given. Right. Now, we draw this one. This will become like a band pass filter. You can see it between that frequency and that frequency is 1, otherwise it's 0. So it's a band pass filter. So let's go back. So when we go back, you can see the input spectrum is there. If you now pass through an A to D converter, you know the amplitude will go from 1 to 1 over T. It's not downsampling, it's an A to D conversion. So now the axis becomes F to theta. You see the A to D converter there? You have seen that? There's your A to D converter. Here's your A to D converter. So this is your digital signal. That's your analog signal. So I'm looking at the analog spectrum and the digital spectrum. When I look at the analog spectrum, that digital spectrum, that this is theta C. You can calculate this. Isn't that right? We have done a lot of questions on that. So you can calculate that. Now the next step is you're going to modulate the signal. And how are you modulating? You're modulating by cos theta naught. Theta naught is given to you. So that's your modulation frequency, theta naught. And you've calculated that already. So what will happen is, you need to apply this particular equation to get the new spectrum. So, okay. So when I apply, what will happen is, this one will move that way, because that's one part of the modulation. And that one will move this way as well, second part, because you've got half x theta plus theta naught, half x theta minus theta naught. And you will find this amplitude is also reduced by half, remember? That's the equation shows you. Go back to the equation. The equation shows there's a half there. Now when you do that, you will find one of them will sit here, the half of that. The other one will be outside the pi. Outside the pi mean it will come back, you work out your value, it will come back in here. When you shift this one to this side, one of them will be here, another one will move outside the pi. Outside the pi mean it will return back in here. So you have to work out these. And you will end up that you've got signal at that one plus those two. But P theta is passed through, go back again, P theta is passed through a filter which has got 125 hertz the bandwidth. So now you go back again, and you can see your bandwidth is 125 hertz, which is 0.15. So it will remove that part, it will remove that part, you end up with that. But we are not finished with that yet. Because what happened is, that has to be now, oh sorry, I went back. Now, that has to be downsampled, you see. Downsampled by 10. Downsampled by 10 means amplitude will reduce and the spectrum will be stretched. So you can see, that point about we multiply by 10, that will become a pi, where this is here, and that point is multiplied by 10, that become pi there, and then this one will be multiplied by 10, so divide by 10 because the downsampling, and that cancel out, and you'll end up with 1 over t. Okay, so that's your final spectrum you need to do. So in this example, you really need to sit down with paper and pencil and work out these values, right? Remember, why does it come back there? The reason is, a spectrum after pi is exactly the same. It's repeating after pi. So that means, outside this means, if you put that back in the top, it will be here. That's the way to think. Okay? So that's the next example of a multi-rate system, a portion of a multi-rate system. Here is another example of a multi-rate system. And it's a bit different, and here you can look at it here. What you have, you get your signal, you will upsample by 2, then you're going to modulate with a different modulation frequency, then pass it through a filter, then you upsample by 7, then pass it through a filter, and then modulate. It's a very complicated one. But it's an example that gives you some idea of how to draw the spectrum. I have actually worked through this example and run through it. And run through the example carefully, so you may be able to look through this yourself. But anyway, let me just run through very quickly. Theta 1, you can calculate them, given. Theta 2 is given. The frequencies, that's that one, and that one is given. D theta is given, that's given. And H theta is given. Now we are ready to write the spectrum. First thing is Xn is given, so you need to find X theta. That's the first part. Without this spectrum, we can't do anything. So we go for X theta. How do you do X theta? X theta, very simple. Here you go. Xn is that. The transform is that. That's simple, isn't it right? That's that to the plus 1. That's nothing. That's that to the minus 1. Then you apply particle e to the j theta. X theta becomes 1 plus cos theta. Okay, you all know that. So now I can say I've got a signal, it's 1 plus cos theta. It's now upsampled by 2. So this x theta, that point, which is equal to 1 plus cos theta, now will become as at that point 1 plus cos 2 theta. Remember spectrum switched? So it becomes 2 theta. So let's continue. So this becomes cos 2 theta now. Once you have got that, you need to now do modulations. So we use the equation now. This is A theta. So this will be modulated between half A theta minus theta 1 because of modulation and theta 1 plus theta. That would now become B theta. So at that point, B theta is now, we know. So all you do, substitute theta minus theta 1 in here instead of theta. So you substitute that, it will be half cos 2 times of theta minus theta 1. Theta 1 is pi over 4, so it will be A cos 2 theta minus pi over 4. This will be theta plus pi over 4. A cos 2 theta plus pi over 4. You can now simplify this using trigonometry, which is very simple to do. It's cos A plus cos B equal to cos A cos B. Or you can use that cos 2 theta is 1 minus 2 cos squared theta. Cos 2 theta equal to 2 cos squared theta minus 1. You can use that formula and simplify that, you will find B theta is 1. So, the gain here, spectrum is 1 at that point. So, when it passes through D theta, it's not going to change much because the amplitude is going to remain the same. So, D theta at that point, I'm now saying, is B theta multiplied by D theta. That and that multiply, that and that in frequency domain multiply, you get D theta. And you know that the spectrum here is pi over 4, it's given band filter.
Here is band limited to pi over 4, it's cut off because it's pi over 4.
So that's what I have written here. Okay. Once you have done that, you are at that point now. Now you have to upsample by 7. So you go to the next equation. What you are getting here is a signal. And so how do we do now upsampling here? D theta. I have D theta here. So I now want to get R theta. So what do I do is, so R theta is equal to E theta multiplied by E theta multiplied by H theta. So E theta here multiplied by H theta. What is E theta? D theta, D, 7 theta is itself E theta because it's going to be upsampled. So D 7 theta multiplied by H theta. H theta is 1. So I don't need to worry about it. H theta is given as 1 between pi over 7. So earlier is pi over 4, now it's going to pi over 7. So what will happen is, this is 1, so that's what left over. So R theta is going to be D 7 theta in the region of pi over 7. Okay? Now what happened is, R theta you got is multiplied by cos, and you got S theta. That means this is going to be, this spectrum is going to be shifted. The spectrum is at pi over 7 is going to be shifted. That means what happened is, R theta is going to be, where is the spectrum? This is the spectrum 1 theta, pi over 4, yes? And that's going to be shifted, and 7 theta, so pi over 4 will become pi over 28. Okay, because 1 over 7, when you multiply, it's become pi over 7. So R theta now, at the moment, is pi over 28 in that region to be 1. And I show it in a diagram. Now this is just a deriving the equation, right? So if you go further, now we are at that point. How do you get that point? S theta equals to half of R theta, that's modulation, half of R theta plus R plus theta. And theta 2 is pi over 3 pi over 4. You substitute that and that one, and you get your signal now. Now you need to work out S theta. How do I work out? I know S theta is that in the range of that one and that one from the previous slide. Or that is in the range of that and that in the previous slide. You can now, if you want, move your 3 over pi to that side, and here also, move that there, and that there. It will simplify to that equation. That's your final S theta. So your S theta will look like, eventually, it's a band pass spectrum, centered around 3 pi over 4. There you are. That's your spectrum. You can actually draw the whole spectrum if you want, one down here there. This is a bit of a difficult problem, but it's important for you to do follow through. When you come across very first time, it looks a lot. Or when you go through a few times and understand the principle, it's very, very simple. Okay? So that's all the chapter that we have come across. The chapter 6 has been completed, and that's all you need to know in chapter. From what I have done, and you refer to a lecture note, there's one example in the lecture notes I haven't covered here, which you can go through and read through them. Okay? I will give you the solutions for quiz 1 also in the next CD. I'll give you the solution, I'll go through the solution so that those who didn't understand can actually understand the explanation. So that will be available to you in the next CD. So for the moment, you should be able to get the CD tomorrow. Tomorrow is Wednesday, from the school office, a copy free of charge. And I would like you to go through the CD, try to follow the notes, try to understand the concept, and tell me later on whether this method of teaching helps you to kind of, you know, your learning outcomes are better this way rather than being in the class all the time. And this does not replace one-to-one teaching. Having said that, this is an additional tool for you. So I won't be repeating this lecture in the class. I want you to follow this lecture, play it on a media player, any media player you can play on this, on your computer, or in our computer room G16 and G19, you can play them and listen to the lecture notes and see whether you have understood and try to do the exercise after this, okay? Thanks very much, and I'm looking forward to your comments on this mode of delivery. Thank you.